This is not a pure Perl talk. At the end, at least, it's not a pure Perl talk. It's more platform independency. Let's first introduce myself for the few people who do not know me. You must be very afraid of me because you're all sitting in the back. That's a bit of a pity. Yeah. So then I don't have to introduce myself. I usually speak very loud without microphone. So I'm Mark from the Netherlands, and I'm a freelance programmer for 13 years now. And I do Perl day and night. I really like Perl, and I have a few very large CPAN modules, email related, XML related, and lately I spent a lot of time in platform dependency related POSIX stuff. So let's show you some things, new developments at the end. No, it's not on. Yeah, now it's on. So probably you all have heard about POSIX some way or the other. POSIX is a standardization effort. In the beginning, when Unix was developed, it got spread out of all different companies working on it, and they all collected their own software tools, and they all designed extensions to the Unix kernel, because there was no central control of AT&T, because they were not allowed to do anything commercial with this beautiful Unix product. So all these Unix dialects diverged more and more, and then you got this at a certain moment competition, other operating systems, and it was very easy for the other operating systems just to say, Unix, what Unix? What are you talking about? We have the standard. We are one. Yeah, Microsoft. If you buy Microsoft, it's always compatible with Microsoft. If you buy Unix, it's incompatible with everything. So you had all these standardization efforts, and POSIX was the main one. It started about in 1984 already. What you have to understand about it is that it's not an enforcing standard, but it describes what it finds everywhere. So I hear a lot of complaints about POSIX, that it's weak, that people do not follow the standard, although they say it. Well, if you read the manual page, you will see exceptions. You read this function is not obligatory, or you only have to support these and these things. So it's a very weak standard. It's more describing what's available and collecting what's available, and there are not so many strict rules to be followed. There are many every few years there is a new release, and the latest is September 2001. So the full name of the standard is then POSIX 1003.1-2000. And not all the platforms are on that level. Some are following older standards, and you can find it out. So often in manual pages on Perl, I read, this function may be available on your platform. Well, you can find out what level of implementation is supported by your platform, and then you can just, without warning in your manual page, you can adapt to that. The administration of this POSIX standard became part of a much larger specification, the single user Unix specification, which is maintained by the Open Group and has currently about 1,200 functions, and then a few more constants. Many constants and many functions in POSIX. Well, it's all based on C. On the C library level, and in C you need constants to pass on flags. We don't have named parameters in C. So what's in there? Well, I really like POSIX because you can do lots of things with the operating system, and I like operating systems. So everything about FileIO and Socket.io, signal handling, timestamps, everywhere where your program has to use its physical environment, it will be in there. Math libraries, for instance. Why is math in there? Because it may run in user space, but the information about hardware, how it runs, what's the maximum floating point number, for instance, that's very system specific. So that's why the interface to this information is standardized. But it's also really difficult to do correctly. And Perl does a lot of things just to hide platform dependencies. And I really like to see platform dependencies. On a certain level of many programmers, if you program a website or so, then it's nice that all the platform dependencies are hidden for you. But if you're writing a server, if you're really implementing a server, the server daemon, then you want to see how the platform behaves. You want to know what a socket can do if you develop a module for event-driven programming. And that's much harder in Perl. So the hiding is okay, but the exposure is too low. Yeah, the knowledge is too low. And understanding POSIX is very difficult. If you see the print, for instance, print is using POSIX somewhere. Somewhere between your Perl program print and the operating system which sends it to your screen or prints to a file, somewhere there is the bytes, the characters of your string have to leave your program and get into your operating system. And this could be a printf on C level, or this could be a write on C level. I don't know what's used here. But my Perl manual page say, printing a string returns true if successful. What means successful here? What? Successful? If you go to the printf manual page, which may be in POSIX, then it says it returns the number of bytes. And of course, we have a big problem between Perl bytes and UTF-8 strings in Perl and so on. So maybe they hide bytes and say only true or false to send back. But even a failing printf, when does a printf fails on operating system level? In my life, I got 3 times people who contacted me about my modules who said, you should check the return code of every print statement. Well, that's really bullshit, because your bytes from your program, they go down into the operating system and they have many layers, and the hard disk is maybe 4 or 5 layers of buffering and logic deep. And so it's not, success is not something like a hard disk failure or non-failure. Yeah, but you will not see it here. Probably, depends on your operating system. But if you check for success here, it's getting into, probably, most often you have buffered I/O, for instance, and then it's also only showing that those bytes are written in your own program, in your own buffers. So you will not see full hard disk. But maybe you just cross across a border of 4 kilobytes of buffer, and it's attempted during your write to send this to the operating system, and there is no cache memory available anymore, or something like that. It could be an error, but it could be that there is cache and it is called by the cache, but just after a while, after seconds, your bytes end up in the hard disk and you get a write error on your hard disk. But this successful doesn't mean that it is on the hard disk. So really understanding what's happening, and if you want to have writing core libraries, for Perl, for instance, if you really are writing the server, a socket communication, for instance, then you really want to see what's happening on all the levels. And then you really start hating Perl's behavior of hiding everything for you and being platform independent. No, in that case, you want to be platform dependent. You want to know how it works. So for another example, of POSIX, select, no, not that select, this select for event-driven programming, and you get some file description bits. I don't know, anyone ever used this select by hand? We did? Oh, great. Good. Well, you have event-driven programming requires certain skills. The skill is that your program is waiting for events to happen. And if some file has bytes for you to read, or if you some buffer is empty, or some event appears, then you have to take some action. So all user interfaces, for instance, are event-driven. You click on a button, and then something happens. But if you click on another button, something else will happen. Well, the POSIX standard is very weak. It says only, yeah, you have to be able to wait on sockets. So Windows is POSIX compliant because you can wait on sockets, but nothing else. Then all Unix systems support waiting on pipes, not Windows. Yeah. Most Unix systems wait on allow files to wait on bytes from files, but not all Unix systems. And Linux, for instance, has many extensions. You can wait on events, on timers, and so on and somewhere, all in the same select loop. It makes event-driven programming much more powerful. So the standard has a lot of optional things, and optional things, and optional things, and so on. So in groups of parameters. So it's a minimum set. Okay, so we have a very beautiful Perl module in core, which is called POSIX-PM, and it's based on POSIX 1993, and it's as old as Perl itself and never been kissed. It's really horrible, and I will show you why. For instance, if you look at POSIX-PM, it tells you that it is complete. It exports about 200 functions out of those 1,200 which are defined in POSIX. Lots of POSIX-PM are just stupid rewrites. So it says, well, on C level in POSIX you have this getPID function, and in Perl we call that $$. Well, maybe you know, but this is not true, because $$ in Perl has something to do with getPID, but depends on the platform. It hides platform differences there. Yeah. It has exports very useful. Loads of names which have some kind of collision. Some are quite harmful, and some are some are just better. But so you have functions which are already existing in Perl somewhere in Perl core, and they just redefine them, re-export the same names. Very useful. I will give some examples. Loads of functions say, "Oh, not implemented. You have to do something else." And some say, okay, it's so C-specific that, we just do not implement it. Hey, we have full POSIX compliance. All the functions are available. Except, those and those. And it exports some constants. And there are about 121 functions useful. Well, useful. Well, not all of them. So let's give me an example of quite harmless. So if you say just in the top of your program, if you say use POSIX without explicitly including anything, you get all of the 538 names. And you get so an overruling of your sin function, for instance, sinus function. Because sinus is a math library, which is POSIX. But the implementation is like this. And in the core, sign has a prototype, underscore. Underscore means if you do not pass a parameter, it will use dollar underscore. But if you have use POSIX in the top of your script, it will overrule the sign with this implementation. This means if you have no parameter, it will be undef. Sign will be called undef. So behavior changes. Ooh. But that's not really harmful. There are more harmful things. If you have used POSIX at the top of your program, you do change own. It has a difference. What's the difference? Do you know what the difference is between the core change own and this one? Well, a lot of functions in Perl core accept arrays. You can just give a whole list of file names. Yeah. But here, if you have used POSIX on top of your program, at once you can only use one file name to change the owner instead of all of them. Ah, this is very nice for bugs. Or this one, where they just have the one has clock ticks and the other one has seconds. Or this one, where the order of the parameters has changed. Kill. Ow, kill is just the other way around, because in Perl core, this is the the real order, this is the usual order where you have the process ID and then the signal name. And this is when you have POSIX included, you can specify more than one process ID at the same time in Perl core. Yeah, so that's why they had this. So in core, they decided to change the order of the parameters, so different from POSIX. But the POSIX module say, oh, let's be smart. Let's have the same order as we did in. Okay, good. Or open. This is the worst thing, because open POSIX open is on file descriptors, and core open is on. This is really confusing. Yeah. So, I started about 4 years ago with a re-implementation of the POSIX PM, and I want to have it in core, but well, it's very difficult to convince people in core to change things, so just on CPAN. And one of the things I did was first inventorize where all these 1200 functions are. Where is the POSIX standard in Perl? If you are coming from another programming language, if you are used to programming in C or so, you know which functions you are looking for, but you don't know where they are. So I created the manual page overview, and then I split up all these functions and in separate manual pages, and not one PM which includes all. So, okay, no explanations as well. Just about adaption to Perl for the POSIX functions, but no detailed explanations. If you have seen how long those manual pages are, the POSIX manual pages, which are usually installed on your Linux system, for instance, they are huge. Don't try to redo that. And also refer to non-core stuff. And that's in core modules, they usually only refer to other core modules and not to CPAN. But when this is a CPAN module, so I can refer to everything. So let's give you a very small abstract. And now you see how messy it is in Perl. So this is just one of the many chapters of the specification. These are the functions which are provided by POSIX. If I write Perl func mean, this is a core function. You can just use the Perl func manual page and read about it. Our script, and this is other places where you can find it. And you see that everywhere scattered around. Yeah? So I split all these POSIX functions, and there are a few more at the moment. And I split all the POSIX pod in pieces and rewrote it to not to lie, because it's lying a lot now. And, well, okay. So, for an example, the math page. So, to create a new POSIX just for math specific, I could just take 10 functions from core. POSIX XS is offering some more. So, POSIX XS is part of POSIX PM. They are linked together. So 17 functions are found in POSIX XS. I'm not re-implementing those, but I only give them the right compatible interface, you know, prototypes. There is one implemented in C, or in Perl, sorry, the power function was only implemented in pure Perl in POSIX PM and not via the interface. There was one function which was implemented in pod. I mean, it said, if you need diff, then you have to use this in your code. Well, that's very stupid. So it was implemented in pod. And there was one missing. So, and then all the related constants. And they are all grouped together in one decent package. So if you use POSIX 1003 math, you don't get 538, but just about 100 functions. That's not enough. This file handle and file confusion about names. So I decided to be different in names to hide confusion between Perl Core and POSIX PM. They're usually quite confused with the POSIX name. So all file descriptor functions are just ending on FD from file descriptor, seek file descriptor, open file descriptor, which is I don't like names name collisions. So then you have the constants, and maybe you follow P5P, but and you have seen that there are some developments on the new constant new error codes and so on being added. What I did is I collected manual pages from all different operating systems, and I scrapped the manual pages for constant names, which are described in those manual pages. Gave me long lists, about 1,800 constant names. And when you install the module, it tries to find that constant name on that platform. So during installation, it auto-detects the names which are used. Yeah, and there are many more constants than we have in PostXPM, and maybe someone wants to use them. So you can use them in different ways. You can, for instance, sysconfig can tell you something about system configuration, so how your libraries are compiled and so on. And here you can see so what's the clock tick on this system? Sysconf is the real function to ask it. Depends on what kind of constant it is. But for instance, if I just use the constant name in this case, I will automatically call sysconf to get the value of this. And you can also see it's also exported as hash. You can just ask which names for sysconfig are available on this platform. So many more names. And well, you need those names if you want to have all these functions. This one is not supported to any CPAN module on the moment, so I have added this. But if you have BSD glob, for instance, you can also use these constants. You know, the glob, the core glob function is implemented mainly in Perl, but the file glob module exports BSD glob, which is also using the C library to do globbing. So file name expansion, and so here you see all these the use of these constants, and there are many constants specific for certain platforms, not generically available, and I will show you later. So I found a number of this is an old list. I found many more constants, and I will provide all these values to you. And during installation, it not only auto-detects the constants, but it also adds them to your manual page, so you can see what they are. Yeah? Long list of constants. If you use PostXPM and there is a constant not available for your platform, you get a very horrible crash. Yeah, it just dies. Oh, I don't have OpenMax on this platform. It's very difficult to handle this if you have a script which is want to use one of those constants. The portability, it's quite difficult to get right. And in my modules, you can just tag them. They return undef if they are not available. You can also see whether they are not available, but usually they are just undef. So if you want to see the max length of a file name on the platform, you can say, well, first I can use the pathconf on the file name to see what, for instance, on Unix systems, it's not a constant anymore. It depends on the files on the disk, the file system on the disk, how long the longest file can be. So you have to pass in the file name with the pathconfig function, and then it tells you on that disk what the longest path can be. But if you don't know that, then you can use this one, or otherwise take this one, or if you have none of those values, just say 512. Yeah. Well, I do not explain how to use these constants correctly. I only provide these constants. If you do it like this, it will break. You know what this value means? It means the shortest file name length which should be accepted by the file systems to be POSIX compliant. So it could be much longer, actually, what you get back. So I don't, but I won't help you. This is the lowest level. POSIX 1003 module sets is the lowest level, and if you want to program correctly, you have to read manual pages. Yeah, that's not my problem. So, well, you can get these functions per module now, or in a short form, you can just say, oh, find out which of these packages you want to have automatically. So most people will be lazy and take the lowest I will all want to have all the path config things at Terma.io and path max and same. So functions or groups of methods and constants in a short way. So now I get on my system about 1100 names, mainly constants. It's about a doubling. So with my project, how much time do I have left? I started half. Okay, my project 15 minutes about, and the previous month is the other way around. I have all these functions. I add more and more functions to my knowledge, but I want to find out what is supported where. If I look at the IEX manual page, I can see constants and functions description on that manual page. If I go to HP, I find different constants. And but on what release of HP has this constant be added? On what release of Linux was this added? And in what release did we get EPOL and so on and so forth? So, and that reverse knowledge is nowhere on internet. I looked for it, couldn't find it. I could find, so if I know the operating system, what do I have, what not? Can I use this constant, and where will I be compatible with? Will I be compatible with AEX, where I have to port my software later on? So I wanted to do something else. I want collect this back. And well, we have a marvelous infrastructure in Perl. And that's CPAN testers. Who knows about CPAN testers? Not everyone. That's a pity. You have smoke tests, older releases of the intermediate development releases of Perl itself are tested on many systems automatically every day and night. But there's another infrastructure where releases to CPAN get tested on different platforms. So you have an old PC, and instead of throwing it away, you just run CPAN testers. You automatically collect every day new release to CPAN, test it against various versions of Perl, and see whether they break or not. And all these reports are just collected back into a beautiful system. And it's very nice. I'll show you the output. I have now. Where did it get? Oh, some way or the other, it closed me off, so it's a bit. Okay, oh, here it's back. So if you go to meta-cpan or search-cpan.org, I have prepared these pages because I didn't know whether my web connection would work. So you can just flip through the pages. But if you go to meta-cpan or search-cpan, you'll find a testers index. And if you go click on that, you'll see this. Currently it's offline because they are working on a new hardware. But these are test reports for one of the releases of the module. And you see on top all kinds of operating systems. And that's not only Unix-like, but there's also Sigwin, and there's also Windows, MS Windows. And then you see the status of your module. Perl releases, so you see loads and loads of reports. You can easily click on these reports and see why it failed on this. The pity thing about it is that the testers of CPAN, so the CPAN testers, they have to maintain their own systems, and they select by hand usually which modules they will test and not test. So they are not testing everything. Certainly if you have an old system, then it's too slow to follow everything what happens on CPAN. But usually people test what they're using themselves, or you have to ask them to test it for you. But still, there are hundreds of reports, even if you are not putting any effort in it to get it tested. So you see, red is bad, and yellow means, oh, something happened before I finished all the tests. And green means, okay, yeah? So what do I do? Well, the test reports, I don't know if you have ever seen a test report. Let's click on them. So these are two test reports. That's why I prepared it. La 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 la. Okay, maybe it will work later. Oh, of course, it's offline. It died, so I will show you soon. When my module finds out that it's being tested under CPAN tests, it extends the test reports which is sent back to CPAN testers with all the constants it found on that platform. So I use it to collect the information back. I don't do it for other people who are not in CPAN testers, but only for when it is running on CPAN testers. And then I have a website which explains how it works. And then I get to the results. From all the reports, I create a manual of pages which give the reverse index. So here, this is a file description IO group. You can see it here. It's a file description IO group. It's bit up. I got for this release that many reports back, and quite a number did not fail, but usually it's not that bad. Sometimes I get partial information back. That's not really horrible. And here you see the operating system versions. Every star is a report, and then red means it broke, but still I got values back, as you see. Green means I got for this exact version release, I got a test, and blue means I didn't get any test report for this exact version, but for previous versions I have still reports. Now here, this is cached on my machine, so I can just click on one. And then, so this is how a test report looks. This is the, if you run make tests, you get the same output. Yeah, but here you see in the output, I just collect what I found from all these constants for this platform. A few, you know. So in the output, well, I have to extend here the way of output. Sorry, yeah. Now there is an environment variable where you can see that it's called automated testing, and if the environment variable is set, then it is CPAN testers. So now I won't offend other people in producing this much output. It depends on the platforms, of course, which I return. The more platforms I get, the more complex these tables get. So I try to evolve with with what I get back. So it will get more complex in the future. You see that the values do change on certain platforms. They are different. And when every color, change of color means that there are other platforms having different values for this. So close on exit, exec, for instance, is a not that old option which many open support. But you see that everyone just picked a different value for it. Yeah. What you can also very clearly see that it depends on the page where you're looking, but in this page it's also visible that, for instance, the BSD that Mac OS X is very closely related to FreeBSD and closely related to Sigwin. For some constants are just the same and very different from the Linux or HP or AX. Or error numbers, which errors on different platforms, and the text for on the different platforms. So this reverse information is nowhere else on the internet, and I'm trying to collect it. So some errors are on there and so on. And let's see. This is properties. Yeah. So people will say that in the 15, I thought, 10, but the people will write in a manual page, your operating system may support a feature. Now, here in this constants, you can find to what level of POSIX standard a certain feature got implemented. So these FreeBSD and Mac OS X, they usually have functions or on these releases, on these operating system releases, they have at least implemented it up to 2001 POSIX standard, December 2001, while Linux is up to 2008 September, so the latest. So you can just find out what you have. It should be used more, I think, on CPAN modules, just to automatically detect what you have and use it when you have it. So, see, there's a lot of information in the platform. Let me see more. This is, all kinds of CLOP functions or lock functions. And so the good thing is we have CPAN testers. But there's also a bad thing, which I discovered. We have CPAN testers, but on a very limited number of systems. I don't think this is much. Don't you think so? Say how many... there is by accident someone running 2.6 kernel, but that's more accidental, and it gave failures. So it was very useful that someone ran that. There are people using NetBSD and OpenBSD, but there's one or two are running OpenBSD tests. And usually those systems are small, and they do not test the whole of CPAN. There's no AEX, there's no HP Unix, Windows, gladly, there are quite a number of Windows users, but my module still has a few problems with Windows. But,
your Linux 2.6
user
uses Red Hat.
Okay, that would be nice. Yeah, you can see it in the report as well, because in the report is written what it is. But I think more people should use CPAN testers or run CPAN testers and beta, especially if you have weird hardware. And then the complaint I say to an AEX user, I say, can you run CPAN testers? And they say, well, most of Linux install tools do not work without help when I install modules. And I say, yeah, but it's exactly the reason why you should run CPAN testers on all the install suites, on all the xutils, MakeMaker, and so on. And they easily break because they are all very system dependent. So any one of you running weird hardware? Having a spare AEX system? Having a... Is it dying out? No, it's not dying out. All these... Yeah. Run around with the mic then. But they are quite expensive. But you know, we are developers, and developers are either using FreeBSD or Linux, as you can see. But many pro programs run with governmental organizations and so on. And those people are not Coil developers, but they are Perl users. And they are often paying me, for instance, to do some work for them. But we need to get those involved, or we need to steal systems from them. You know, or how do we call that? Get our hands on second-hand systems. To run CPAN testers. Of course, there are more infrastructures. GCC has an infrastructure just to test the GCC compiler on a weird number of platforms. And it has been used for some core Perl testing, so for just Perl itself. But those systems are usually too small. So they are already overloaded with GCC compilations and cross-checking. So and it's also not our... Many of those systems are also not interesting for us. You know? We should have more. So. Questions about this project or about POSIX and Perl? Or yeah. Wait for the mic, please.
Could you run virtual systems for CPAN testing and maybe virtualize all these weird old systems?
Are there limitations for virtual systems or not? Well, in a virtual system is sometimes a bit hard. I think we can use it, but virtual systems have usually come with libraries, C libraries and stuff, which got compiled on some platform. And it's good for CPAN testers probably, but not for my module to get a realistic view on what operating system supports. But yeah, to CPAN testers, it will be very nice just to run all kind of weird versions of platforms. So, more questions? No? I can, if you want, I can show you. Oh, yeah? A bonus slide, yeah. Let me see where it is. It's doing weird stuff. I decided just to show you how poor POSIX PM sometimes is. Let me enable a few slides. I don't know, probably there's a button for that, but yeah. Just to see, you can find this in the POSIX PM manual page. A very useful function is POSIX standard is lower. Well, you know how to do that in Perl, you. Lowercase. So what's the reason to have an is lower, export an is lower from POSIX PM? Yeah? But then you start reading it and you say, this is identical to the C function. Something in Perl identical to C? Except that it can apply to a single character or to a whole string. Yeah, well, lowercase, yeah, it's a macro usually in C where it always works on a string, so on a single character. So it works on, but single characters in Perl, it can work on a single character or a whole string. We have only strings, so it's very different. Yeah, this line says this is lower. It's very different from the POSIX is lower. Yeah, it's not identical. Note that locale settings may affect what characters are considered lower. Hmm. Does not work on Unicode characters above to what Unicodes in Perl? Consider using regular expressions. Yeah, so this text, not only for is lower, but also for is upper and so on and friends, is copy-pasted about 10 times in that manual page. So this POSIX PM module is really, really in big need for some freshing up, and I don't think it should be in Perl Core. Anyway, why is getPBNum in Perl Core? Even outside POSIX PM, why is setuid in Perl Core? It should be just on CPAN. Yeah, you won't have also new releases, bug fixes, extensions, and so on for older Perl versions. It shouldn't be in Core. How is it in Perl 6? Get PBNum in Perl 6? Get setuid in.
It goes into a module.
It goes into a module. Yeah, that's the good way. So can we do it for Perl 5? Can we just for the next release for Perl 5 get this into a module as well? POSIX PM? Yeah, don't. So, okay. Well, that's my message. So, if there are no more questions, then we still have 5 minutes extra break. Okay, thank you.